When you're in China, are you going to be having a different series of conversations with the Chinese leaders? By which I mean a lot of China experts look at what is happening in China and say, you are seeing a new form of nationalism, you are seeing a new, specifically anti-Western and anti-American nationalism, whether it's regard to cyber theft and cyber crime, cyber attacks, the way Western companies are treated, the business in the South China Seas where China is doing what apparently violates international law and is worrying its neighbors. Yeah. Is it time to get tougher on China?
Well, first of all, I don't think any of that's new. Remember, China's been run during our lifetimes by a communist party that has been much more anti-Western in the past. We went through a period over the course of 20 years in the 90s and on through maybe the onset of my presidency, where because state-sponsored capitalism and an export-driven model was very successful, China was less interested in making waves. But, you know, you got over 1 billion people, one of the largest economies now in the world, and so it's to be expected that they will want a bigger seat at the table when it comes to international affairs. And what we've said consistently is we welcome the peaceful rise of China consistent with international norms. That's good for everybody. An impoverished and collapsing China would be dangerous for everybody. And you know, we should want China to take on more responsibilities, not only for its own people, but also for a wide range of international problems and conflicts, whether it's climate change or disaster relief or dealing with things like Ebola. But what we have said to the Chinese, and we've been firm consistently about this, is you have to recognize that with increasing power comes increasing responsibilities. You can't pursue mercantilist policies that just advantage you now that you are a middle-income country in many ways, even though you still have a lot of poor people. You know, you can't just export problems. You've got to have fair trade and not just free trade. You have to open up your markets if you expect other people to open up their markets. When it comes to issues related to security, if you sign a treaty that calls for international arbitration around maritime issues, the fact that you're bigger than the Philippines or Vietnam or other countries in and of itself is not a reason for you to go around and flex your muscles. You've got to abide by international law. And part of what I've tried to communicate to President Xi is that the United States arrives at its power in part by restraining itself. And when we bind ourselves to a bunch of international norms and rules, it's not because we have to, it's because we recognize that over the long term, building a strong international order is in our interests. And I think over the long term will be in China's interests as well. So where we see them violating international rules and norms, as we have seen in some cases in the South China Sea, or in some of their behavior when it comes to economic policy, we've been very firm, and we've indicated to them that there will be consequences. But what we've tried to emphasize to them is if you are working within international rules and international norms, then we should be partners. There's no reason that we cannot be friendly competitors on the commercial side and important partners when it comes to dealing with the many international problems that threaten both of us.